Greetings one and all, this is Lloyd Brown. Welcome to part two of this very splendid, splendiferous, wonderful, exciting, exhilarating. I've got no more superlatives
knowledge.
Left. I've got no more superlatives left. But welcome to the second part of this very special interview alongside Lloyd Mullins, aka DJ Wamanizi, for she's in my knees. Right? And the first episode we was basically talking about your childhood and just music more or less coming to you.
Coming to me, yeah.
You know what I mean?
As a youngster
and absorbing the reggae music and its influences on you in your time at school as a youth.
Yeah.
So now we're more or less going into the adolescent time, yeah. Your late teens and what have you, and you advancing from more or less just listening to music to actually going into sound systems, being around sound systems. So, you know, tell a story.
Right, well, so after, as I mentioned, we went to this place called Donkey Pen. It was a regular place that we used to go on a Friday and Saturday to listen to sound system, which was, there was another sound called Ital Earthquake, which became, they changed their name in the future to Freedom Studio. And there's a story about that later on as well. But going there regular, a few of our friends were venturing into London, which we didn't know. They ended up coming down to Donkey Pen and saying, no man, you need to come to London, man. That's where all the action is. That's where all the girls are.
They got London, thing
London
can
swing. You know, jump on a train about midnight. Don't know how we're going to get back. About 14, 15 of us travel down to London, to Mile End, to listen to Fat Man's song.
Wow.
You know, with Roy Rankin as the DJ, with Raymond Naptali and Ribs as the selector. You know, and that was a real learning curve. Now we're hearing real proper stuff that we want to hear now.
Absolutely.
You know, lovers music as well as roots rock reggae, you know. We also used to listen to Shaka on the odd occasion.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and if you were looking for girls now, you got to Fat Man's song, where they used to play the
song. I say that I go out Fat Man.
Yeah, man, Fat Man was a big thing.
Yeah, man, we're big on Fat Man, Fat Man, the legendary Fat Man, you know what I mean? It's like, you know, Fat Man is synonymous with sound system. You know, from the 70s, 80s, even to this present day, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, your contribution in at this thing is immense and vast and huge. So, you know, not feel so we forget you,
no,
you know what I mean?
No
not
way.
Feel so we forget the sound system thing, because the sound system was indicative of how this reggae business, I won't say industry now, but this reggae business, how it came to be and how it came to fruition.
We also used to listen to other sound as well, like Lard Cools, you know, Salad David, who else? Count Shelley, Admiral Ken, Sufferers Hi-Fi. Sufferers came to Luton a couple of times as well and played.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that was with Dennis Bovell as the selector.
And you know what? To be honest with you, I mean, Count Shelley for me is like, that name only became synonymous with me by the labels.
By
the record labels. And there's two songs on that label that will always stay in my mind.
Margaret's one.
No. Nope. And they're both by the same artist. They're by Honey Boy. One was, I got to find Sweet Cherry. She's gone away from home. That one.
Fight Life?
No, and Impossible Love.
Impossible Love.
Which were both covered by UB40 in their Labour of Love albums, which I conversed with Patrick a few episodes ago.
Now let me stick up in there, like, because do you know that Honey Boy used to live in Luton as well? Honey Boy Williams are talking.
Yeah, Honey Boy Williams. He lives in Brazil now.
Yeah, he lives in Brazil now, but he used to live in Luton and he used to do a radio show on Chilton Radio as well every week.
I did not know that.
Yeah, he was there for about a good 8-9 years on Chilton Radio.
Keith Williams was his name, right?
Yeah.
AKA Honey Boy, man.
Honey
big,
Boy,
up.
We're big up Honey Boy out there in Brazil right
large
now.
Large up.
Living it large out there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Lucky git.
Yeah.
so you're saying that, you know, so the sounds that was more or less around you at the time was Fat Man and Count Shelley and who else?
Admiral Ken. Ken was a big promoter at the time.
That's right,
he used to bring the artists them over from Jamaica.
From Jamaica and the States as well.
Yeah.
You know, because he ran Dougie's, when it was called Dougie's or Palace Pavilion, but it's the same place in Lower Clacton, just by the roundabout.
Yeah.
And I remember looking on his wall in the club, he brought over Barry Gibb from the Bee Gees, you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah. Big
how a man can have so much influence like that, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. But, you know, he was well known. And then you had Count Suckle, right?
Count Suckle, yeah.
And he ran the People's Club.
Yeah.
I remember that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember going to People's Club a good few times, and
but that was a great era, you know. We used to have a lot of sound clash that time as well.
Yeah.
Between different sound. We used to go to Cubies and Phoebe's Club and Club Norwich, which was in Cricklewood, I believe it was.
No. Club Norwich was just down the road from my yard. I lived in Pembroke Road.
Okay.
Tottenham N15. You come out of my yard, you turn left, you can see Club Norwich right there. Why do I remember? Because I used to sneak in that place. I used to climb out my window, right? And climb over like around 6 garden fence of my other neighbours, and they would see me climbing over the fences as well, you know, and going to Club Norwich and taking in Jashaka,
yeah,
and Boss Cox, Sounds,
yeah,
and Boss Sounds as well, yeah, and Coxon had a residency there as well, yeah.
And Four Aces was another club we used to go as well in Hackney.
Wow, yeah. Four Aces.
A little small club, but it's historic. A lot of history there.
Yeah, well. Absolutely, because the sound that I was. The sound that I was basically running around with that time was Jamaica's sound, and we had a residency in Four Aces as well. So yeah, that era, as far as sound systems was concerned, you know, the UK sound system, it was huge. It was huge.
And the other thing about growing up in the late 70s and early 80s as well, we used to have a lot of house blues, what they call house blues, where sound string up in a house, and there was no problem. Every week you'd have a blues going on somewhere. You wouldn't even have to print flyers because it'd be word of mouth. You could have a sound playing on the road here, and then further up the road a next sound playing, and both parties are full of people.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, there was a teamwork amongst the people as well that owned these sounds. You know, if you're keeping a dance this week, we might not keep one because you're keeping one. You know, and it used to run smooth, but you know, time changed. You know, and as I said, going to house blues, I used to enjoy that because you could get close.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it was the time of release. And when I say that,
from working in factory.
And I mean, not only that. I mean, we had some strict like sus laws back then in the day. Do you know what I'm saying? It's like literally, you just, you know, you don't have to be driving to be stopped.
Yeah,
you could just be walking the street and get stopped on a regular. And them time, the police didn't play. It's like the police were—they weren't institutionally racist. They were outwardly racist.
Yeah,
do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And them time is like, you know, people would just turn a blind eye to what we was basically going through. That's why when you had you had the Rock Against Racism movement, you had stalwarts like Linton Kwesi Johnson, who basically used his music to protest about these things. And you know, you had the punk movement,
that
walked alongside the reggae movement.
Yeah.
You know, when you had bands like The Clash, and they would sing songs like Police and Thieves, which was sung by Junior Mervyn. And that to me was like the amalgamation of the two cultures uniting against the cancer that was and still is racism in this country.
I mean, there was a lot of riots around that time as well, wasn't there?
Yes.
There was that fire that happened where all those people
died. The New Cross Fire,
yeah.
Yeah, you know.
So it was a sad period as well as a nice period for the reggae music, you know.
Yeah. And I think from then, personally speaking, in my humble opinion, I think that's when the roots element of reggae music from the UK, you know, kind of made a resurgence, because you had Aswad, you had Steel Pulse, you had Misty in Roots, and acts like those. Do you know what I'm saying? Because
and from foreign as well, we used to listen to a lot of Big U. Big U had a big influence in the roots music as well. I don't think he gets the credit now for what he did of that period. It was like coming up, it was like U-Roy, then you had Dennis Al Capone, you had Prince Jazbo, you had DJ Clash between them two as well, Prince Jazbo and I-Roy. I-Roy was another artist that I listened to coming to London. Okay, I remember coming to a dance in London once, and I'm in the dance with my friends, and we hear this guy on the mic, and I'm thinking, wait, that record, they sound wicked with I-Roy. They said, he's over there on the mic. I didn't know that he lived in London at the time. You know, I-Roy is one of my idols as a DJ as well. So there was a lot of, as well as the UK artists, as well, and all, we listened to Big Ute a lot as well, you know.
See.
Big influence in the 80s for roots music.
Right. So which sound systems was you heavily around that you was more or less, I mean you did say before we started shooting that you followed a lot of sound, but which sound was you
local less... sound or from local sound, it would be Falcon at that time.
Right.
And then we had another sound came on later on called Gemini Sound.
Okay.
Which is where Prince Malachi, you now know him as Prince Malachi.
Okay.
He was a DJ at the time on the sound. And then after that we had Sovereign Roadshow as well, which I played on as a selector. you know, coming from radio, I used to select music with them as well, mm-hmm. with Crucial Robbie. So yeah, that was a good era. But in London now, it was mainly Fat Man sound that I used to go and listen to. Yeah. And then we used to listen, when Ribs used to select Fat Man sound, as you know, and after that he built his own sound called Unity. So we used to follow Unity as well, because had Richard Ribs. Davies,
Ribs. Twins,
Ribs. Ribs anyway.
I don't have to say anything because you know, your contribution speaks enough at the end of the day.
So. And I mean, you know, enough people talk about top selectors in UK, but to me, you know, he was my idol. I used to watch him. That's another thing. I used to go to dance, and not just dance. I used to watch the operator,
right.
how they take the music out and select the music, put it back in the sleeve.
Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm. I wanted to do that as well. You know, that was all in the back of my mind. In the future, I want to do
something that was the sign of mm-hmm. great things to come, because mm-hmm. it's a natural progression.
It is, yeah.
It's a natural progression because, you know, There's many people that will, you know, that will go on sound systems or go on stage, and they like to sing, mm-hmm. they like, you know, they like getting the forward, mm-hmm. they like to be, you know, the focus of attention, which is fine, which is all good, but you know, you can only do so much for so long.
And in them days as well, you had to have some sort of talent before you could even get the mic, you know.
Yes.
You know, if you want to come on the sound and DJ or sing, you have to make one of those sound men hear you.
Yes.
And then they'd introduce you to the operator. Say, listen, this man can sing, you know, bring him in. And you get, nowadays it's like X Factor. You get a lot of people come on and they ain't got what it takes, but they get the stage anyway.
Yeah.
You
know,
which is a shame.
Which is a very important thing that you, the important point that you make, because, you know, with sound system culture, the way how it was then, you know, we still had to go through the protocol mm-hmm. of more or less audition. We auditioned because the sound, you know, took a time to build up their name.
Yeah.
So them no one, no Mickey Mouse DJ come flop their career. Yeah, you get what I'm saying? So the protocol would be, all right, yeah, such and such. Y'all go out with something. All right. Do I look at something?
Mm.
And from the moment you do something, if you get a big forward, then that's cool.
You can keep the mic.
You can keep the mic. But it's like, okay, don't get carried away though. You know what I'm saying? You know, and you know, you practice and basically become more better at it. But if you didn't cut it from the get-go, you wouldn't get a chance at that mic for a good long time.
And it was
still.
The same with radio as well. When you went into pirate radio, where I came from anyway, you had to do a demo for the station owner, and if the demo you wasn't good enough in it, you wasn't getting a show.
Right.
You know, when it's all part of learning, it was all, you know, it's like doing an apprenticeship. You know, so yeah, and that was another part of my career we talk about as well, you know, for pirate radio. I have to give respect to the pirate radio. I know they talk about royalties and stuff, but they're playing a lot of music that mainstream wasn't playing anyway at that time.
Well, yeah, for me personally speaking, you know, pirate radio has always been at the grassroots of our culture.
We now know it as community radio.
Community radio, you know. And it's a double-edged sword. I wouldn't even say it's a double-edged sword, but there's a trade-off. It's like, you know, they will play the music that commercial radio stations won't play the music, but at the same time, you're not going to get no royalties for that. And, you know, on balance, it's acceptable that is basically...
In that instance, it is
it's wholly acceptable. So it's not like, you know... It's not like we're beating down the community stations. We know that your hands are tied in certain regards. But we will get to the radio thing in due course, because the next thing we're going to talk about when we close off this episode is the 80s dancehall scene.
Mm.
And this is one of the reasons why I wanted to do an interview with you, Lloyd, simply because of your knowledge. I mean, we can sit down on the phone, on WhatsApp, and talk for like two and a half hours.
Straight, yeah.
And we do that.
Yeah.
And there's very few people that I can count on one hand that I can literally go on the phone and talk about music for 2.5 hours. So when I know I can talk to somebody for 2.5 hours about music, then their passion for the music is evident. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So we're going to get into the 80s dancehall on the next episode. So people... thanks for watching. Stand by. We're soon forward.